and welcome to the Culture Cast. I'm Chris Stashew, and I am joined by one of my good friends, the head writer and owner, all-around good guy of Pulp Serenade, your friend and mine. Well, maybe not your friend, but he could be, I guess, if you met him, Mr. Cullen Galley.
Howdy.
Cullen, fantasy movie. Before we talk about the movie we're about to talk about.
Oh, I thought it was just like a question like, oh, like fantasy baseball, your fantasy movies.
I was getting excited. Cullen, what do you think about the fantasy genre? I mean, you have a website called Pulp Serenade. It's not called Fantasy Serenade, so.
I don't know a heck of a lot about fantasy. It's not a genre of movies that I'm spectacularly familiar with, or books for that matter.
Sure. I'm right there with you. I've started reading Lord of the Rings two times, and this most recent time I've gotten farther than I have before, and I'm sure someone in the audience just rolled their eyes at me and said, that's not the fantasy books you should be starting to read. I mean, Lord of the Rings, I was under the impression, is like a pillar of the fantasy genre. But we're not talking about Lord of the Rings yet. But we are talking about a film with a lot of Australian actors in it. And this was a film that was requested to be watched through Patreon, so that's a thing. We're going to be talking about 2010's The Legends of the Guardians, The Owls of Gahool.
Legend tells of a band of noble guardians sworn to vanquish evil and to save our kingdom. But they remain lost in the mists of Gahool, hidden to all but those who believe.
Stop! You're gonna give her daymares.
But this is my favorite part.
You have a soft head, Soren, filled with stories and dreams.
There's nothing wrong with dreams.
My soldiers.
It is time to take the Owl Kingdoms.
Are doing something terribly wrong.
And you're gonna need to fly a long way to get to the Guardians.
You mean they're real?
Oh, they're real, all right.
What are we gonna do, Soren?
We're gonna find the Guardians of Gahool.
You've all come this far, each protecting the other.
When you have flown as far as you can, you're halfway there.
What did he say?
We're halfway there.
There are some really scary beasts out that way.
You can breathe now.
What are they really doing here?
They've built an army.
Powerful enough to take over all the Owl Kingdoms.
Go tell the Guardians!
On his way to finding the legend, he will become one. You too can be a great Guardian.
I bet you didn't count on this.
Hold on!
Come on, Soren. We're not finished yet, boy. Be a young owl with a taste for adventure, arriving at the tree for the first time.
Legend of the Guardians, the Owls of Gahool.
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Owls.
Owls who?
Ha, that's right, owls who?
If I have to hear any more of his ridiculous owl jokes.
Hilarious.
So the film is directed by Zack Snyder. Yes, the Zack Snyder who has directed such films as Justice League, Batman vs. Superman, Watchmen. Man of Steel. That's the other one.
300.
300, yeah, that as well. The film is based on the book series Guardians of Gahool by Catherine Lasky. It stars Jim Sturgess, Hugo Weaving, David Wenham, Anthony LaPaglia, Helen Mirren, Jeffrey Rush, Joel Edgerton. It's got a lot of people. It has a huge cast, which we will talk about the cast, I'm sure, at some point. However, before we get to that, Cullen, I know you had never seen this film before. I had never seen this film before. So, your first watch of Legends of the Guardians, The Owls of Gahool, what did you think?
This was one of the weirder movie-watching experiences that I can recall for a number of reasons, one of which is I think this is one of the more normal movies I've watched, especially during pandemic.
Which is saying something. given it's a film about owls in a magical land.
Yes, and I think we could talk more about it, but in short, it's what I mean by normal is this is a movie that millions of people saw. Like, this was in theaters all over the U.S., all over the world, in multiplexes and malls, in, you know, most of the movies that I have been watching, especially since pandemic started, have been on, you know, Mike White's projection booth, Friday Night Triple Features, or Spectacles, Blood Brunch, and Fist Church Mystery Kung Fu and Horror Movies on Sundays. So watching something that millions of people watched and took their kids to was not my usual fare. Speaking of kids, the other reason why this is really strange is I was never a fan of kids' movies as a kid.
Sure, I'm with you on that.
And I didn't grow up watching them. So watching something like this is just really bonkers to me. Like, the narrative, the characters, like, the role that the kids play in the story and what they encounter is just so foreign to me. So it was, I watched it twice because I just felt it was just something so foreign to me that I wanted to get a little more familiar with it. So that said, I didn't even say what I think of it.
I was going to say, tell me what you thought, sir?
I don't know. I don't have, like, I have nothing planned for however long this conversation goes. I don't know what the next word out of my mouth is going to be. It was a challenging movie. It was very different for me. It's not my type of movie. I can't say I loved it, but it was fascinating to see certain archetypes and narrative tropes that go back to, like, Star Wars and stuff like that, that I could recognize from other movies.
So you've opened a box that I think we should address before we continue further into this conversation. If
my childhood? Yes, Dr. Chris.
No. Yes, hi, Cullen. Have a seat, would you please? Help yourself to some bottles of water. Do you need a coffee? No, I was going to ask you, so you mentioned that, you know, when you were a kid, similar to myself, you know, movies for your age clearly were not something that you got into. If you can think back, and I'm not talking about when you were a kid, but if you can think back, is there a film that is, quote, ostensibly made for children that you do gravitate towards and like? I mean,
I grew up in front of, you know, I was born in 85, and I grew up in front of the TV. So we had, like, HBO and Showtime and Cinemax. You know, I Rambo, all of the Stallone, all of the Schwarzenegger movies. That's what I loved. I think when I was, like, 7, my mom introduced me to Deliverance because she knew I liked Burt Reynolds because I had seen Smokey and the Bandit. I think I saw Apocalypse Now when I was 7 because I'm like, oh, wait, people in, you know, camouflage with machine guns, great. So, yeah, watching narratives with kids was never something that I really dealt with a lot in terms of, like, movie,
sure,
you know, narratives.
Sure. No, I completely get it. I mean, I think, and this is, we're going to talk a little bit about this when we talk about the film, but I think there has been a disappointing lack of creativity when it comes to programming for, I would say, YA to children. It always feels like, to me at least, they take the easiest route to make the film because the assumption is kids are dumb, they will like anything put in front of them, and we don't have to try. As long as we can make toys, as long as they can leave the theater wanting to buy a stuffed animal version of whatever's on screen, they will be satiated, and that's all we have to do. I mean, you get things that break that mold, but I mean, that's that cynical part of me that makes me say, like, yeah, I'm with you. That's why I never really could get into similar films, because even as like a older kid, I still wanted more. I mean, I read above my age level. You know, that it's just, I never wanted to watch things that were more kid focused.
Yeah, same. I was always looking for an escape from being a kid. I will give this movie credit that it, you know, it does go to some dark places. The conflict between the two brothers, the two owl brothers. I don't know if there's a scientific term for owl brethren, but especially at the end, you know, when they have their final showdown.
Sure.
That's pretty dark. And sort of the path that the brother goes down, you know, is, you know, quasi like Proud Boy or some shit like that.
Boy, a little close to home, huh? It's
I mean, maybe it's just from the election, but that's when he gets, you know, he's part of like the pure, I can't remember what they're called, the pure owls, the pure ones. And, you know, it's all about, you know, dominating your opponents and power. And it's just like, yeah, this is some like cult shit that he gets into.
So this film is about an owl and his brother, played by Jim Sturgis and Ryan Kwaten. And these two brothers end up getting knocked out of their nest, and they're kidnapped, and they're taken to a owl. It's like I don't know, they're like pure breed owls, pure ones is what they're called. And the one brother, played by Jim Sturgis, kind of rebels against being kidnapped and leaves to go look for the guardians, the guardians of Gahul, who are these kind of mythical owls that look out for all the other owls. And these bad owls, led by Metalbeak, end up, you know, kind of convincing Soren's brother to come and come in with them and help them kind of push this owl purity. As I mean, that's that we're not reading into it. That's the literal name of these owls are called the Pure Ones. And to your point, now I see what you meant. And I didn't even really put two and two together, which is shocking given essentially this shit's all over the news all the time. But I had never seen this film before, but I have friends who have been trying to get me to watch this film for as long as it's been out, a decade at this point. And this friend of mine donated on Patreon, and now I'm watching it. You and I both watched it. And you know what I can say? Outside of the action scenes that I found to be pretty much par for the course when we're talking about stuff with Zack Snyder.
Yes.
I found it to be a rather enjoyable film. And I don't for one second think that this film is for children. It is.
Oh, interesting.
I don't find it to be for kids because it is really dark.
Yeah, I mean,
there's a point where there's characters being brainwashed, like, permanently.
Yeah. Yeah, it's I guess that's what's kind of strange about it to me, is because I agree, there is a lot of dark stuff. I think sort of the political allegory is not that veiled. It's pretty, you know, upfront, you know, about, you know, brainwashing people, putting them in a cult. But that does still have, like, I think a lot of elements of kids' films, like, you know, there's a lot of reassuring of the character, like, oh, you can fly. Oh, look, show me what you can do.
Right,
he's trying
sure.
to flap his wings. Like, even though he doesn't do a good job, it's like, you did a great job. It's like, all throughout the movie, whenever he tries, even though he doesn't succeed, they're always like, you did great. And then later when they put him in, like, a trial and he has to fly during a storm and he almost dies, and he has to be rescued. It's like, he's like, oh, I'm sorry. And it's like, no, you did great. Maybe I have some issues with characters being told they do a good job.
I was about to say, that's kind of what it sounds like. Maybe this is like a weirder, there's a weirder issue than I thought we were going to be having with this. That's a little bit more esoteric.
But that's what I think. Like, to me, this was a really strange movie for me to watch, because I don't watch movies that have this sort of like reassuring aspect to them. And like, from like a film sociological angle, that was fascinating to me. That's just not something I normally encounter. So those were the things that really jumped out to me.
I'll tell you what jumped out to me, and this is not going to be nearly as deep as what you're talking about. You know, for a film that's a decade old at this point, and it's all CGI completely. There are no live performances. There are no actual owls. They are all CGI. A decade later, I'm pretty surprised at how good it looks.
Yeah, the animation's terrific.
Right? It's really good. But you run into the problems that you run into with action films essentially filmed after 2006, where the director is convinced that you have ADD like he does, and he can't linger on a shot during a fight scene or an action scene for longer than 2 seconds. And here's the thing. I'm not coming up with this argument out of the blue. It's an argument, and it's a criticism that's been leveled against contemporary action films since as long ago as Transformers. I mean, probably before that, at least.
Do you know Cinemetrics?
I do not.
Is the name of the site? Oh my goodness, it's going back to my grad school days. Yuri Sivian, I think, is the guy who runs it or started it. But it's all sort of like analyses of shot length in movies over time. So people are like timing Ozu and Kurosawa movies over the course of their career and like uploading the data and graphs and stuff. Yeah, I find like average shot length, you know, seeing how those change over time, really fascinating. And yeah, shit's, when you said 2 seconds, I'm like, I bet a lot of these shots in action movies are less than that.
Yeah, I mean, I might be a little generous, because there are a couple scenes in this film, namely early on, you have the character of Grimble, played by Hugo Weaving, and he's protecting the two kind of early on main characters, the Jim Sturgis character and the Emily Barclay character, and he's protecting them from the character played by Helen Mirren, who's one of these owl purity characters, one of the two main villains other than Metalbeak, played by Joel Edgerton. And I couldn't for the fucking life of me figure out what was going on, because it was just boom 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 boom, and they're like flying in what looks like a kind of like a rock tunnel, and it's just hard to follow what's going on. And it's not that I've gotten old and I don't know how to process movies. It's that they don't seem to think it's important to give an action scene room to breathe and kind of flow to it. It's just about show us all the cool shit real fast and then it's over.
The irony is that this style sort of fluctuates between that and the opposite extreme, when everything is so slow motion that like nothing actually happens. Because there are all those close-ups of owls, and, you know, it takes multiple seconds for them to move a tiny bit, and you just see the mouth, like, huh. And, yeah, I don't really like either extreme, when it's, like, so manipulated that time almost stops.
Yeah, it's like there's no middle ground, right? It's either this frenetic, psychotic action pace. And look, it's not just a CGI thing. It is a action movie thing. I mean, you could have had a scene with two human actors fighting, and it would still have the same problems as a film with two owls fighting each other if they were doing 2 second quick cuts. I mean, look at action films of today. This is not a new criticism. It's just, we don't watch a bunch of contemporary action films on this podcast. And so when we do run into something like this, that is indicative of the way that action films are now being done, because this is an action film, it's a fantasy action film, the film suffers.
I think it's also worth pointing out that they have, you know, editing action scenes, you know, back to the silent days, you know, they would cut out some frames or, you know, speed up the cranking to make the action look more hectic. And then you have someone like Sam Peckinpah and the Wild Bunch, you know, having, you know, these really dramatic, slow motion scenes. You know, then there's also the stuff where, like, you know, someone starts to fall off a water tower in slow motion, then it cuts to, you know, some more machine gunning, and it cuts back, he's still falling, cuts to some more machine gunning, cut back, he's still falling, cut to something else, the guy is still falling like 30 seconds later. But these sort of tendencies of both, you know, using slow motion for dramatic purposes, you know, increasing the speed in some sort of artificial way to speed up the action. I think you're right that it has reached this sort of almost like absurd pinnacle. You know, what Peckinpah was doing was, you know, more original back then, and now 60 years later, it is like the norm.
Not only is it the norm, but it's almost like fucking expected. Like, you expect that these action scenes are not going to give you something coherent to look at. It's just going to throw as much at the screen as possible and hope that you're able to somewhat pick out what's going on. I mean, that's the issue here. I literally could not have given two shits less about the action scenes in this movie, but everything else that was going on, I was actually rather invested. But the action scenes are terrible.
Are the action scenes pastiche? Because like I've only seen part of Justice League. So this is the only Zack Snyder film I've seen complete.
Sure.
But the action scenes, I'm just like, oh, this is what he did in 300, because that, you know, the angle, like the lighting, the colors, you know, the look on the faces, he has a really distinctive way of filming action, and I've seen trailers and bits of that movie and stuff from his other films. And the action scenes in this movie is like, yes, this is Zack Snyder, .. with owls. So my question to you is he sort of poking fun at himself in this distinctive style? Like, when the owls come right in front of the camera and they slow down at some weird distorted angle, and then the blades go right in front of, their face. Is that supposed to be I recognize that style. Like, this is what normally happens with humans. Isn't this kind of fun? Or is he just straight up this is my style? I don't know the answer.
Before I answer your question, I will say this much. As someone who is a massive detractor of Zack Snyder and his style, and someone like Michael Bay and his style, because they are very similar in a lot of ways. And Zack Snyder's pastiche, to your point, is, and has always been, and that's the joke that always gets leveled against him, and it's not a joke when it's true, is his overusage of slow motion. And, and you see it in this film a little bit, but it's a lot more restrained than Justice League or even 300, which I think is the serial offender when it comes to slow motion. Because don't you know, when stuff's in slow-mo, it looks cooler. Wrong answer. Not always. That's not guaranteed that a guy throwing a punch in slow motion is much more interesting than a guy throwing a punch at normal speed. To answer your question, though, I don't think Zack Snyder has the wherewithal to poke fun at himself. I think Zack Snyder is doing the Zack Snyder thing with owls, but what I think he realized is it's infinitesimally harder to do the Zack Snyder thing with owls than it is to do with actors. And I think that comes down to the size of the creature or character on screen. When you have a human on screen, and it's an actual actor, there are going to be limitations within a reason. In Legends of the Guardians, it's a film about CGI owls that could have... I mean, you and I both know this could have gone off the rails when it comes to CGI and the manipulation of slow motion or speeding it up. It really could have gone off the rails, right? I mean, this is a completely CGI film. And it somehow doesn't. And it's weird that a film that's completely CGI, which Zack Snyder has never done anything full CGI other than this. To answer your question, it's oddly fucking restrained for a movie where he could have just really gone nuts with the Zack Snyder thing.
Okay, that's funny. I mean, for someone not familiar with this stuff, especially on a second viewing, it just, all those hallmarks that I've heard and seen from bits and pieces of his movies were just so apparent. Which, I mean, to his credit, this is his style.
You can't escape your style.
Yeah,
it's like asking someone to write in a different handwriting, right? Like, you can't do it. You physically can't force yourself to do it.
If someone likes his style, and clearly someone does because he's getting these movies and they're huge budgets, it's not my style, but his imprint is on the movie, and it's his work. So
I don't think he has much of a style, though, outside of action scenes, right? Like, when it's not an action scene in this movie, it's anybody could have directed it. He doesn't add any flair to the quieter moments. He doesn't add anything to the more kind of introspective character scenes. All it is a pretty by-the-book animated feature that happens to be directed by one of the highest-grossing action film directors of the last 15 years. But even the thing that he's here for, you brought Zack Snyder here to do a movie about owls fighting each other. And he doesn't even go he doesn't even go all the way Zack Snyder. And that's the weird part for me, is if you told me this film was directed by Zack Snyder and I didn't know who directed it, I would say, okay, sure, that's a Zack Snyder film. But it didn't have the over abuse of certain things that I expect from Zack Snyder, and that's what's more surprising to me. Because something like Justice League or Batman versus Superman or Man of Steel, it's just like giant gaps in logic, giant bombastic explosions and scenes where characters are being thrown through windows and buildings and everything else. And you get to this movie and it's rather restrained. And I'm shocked by that.
I mean, the script moves pretty fluidly, and I appreciate that it doesn't stop to get really caught up in its own logic, in the rules of this world and the characters. You know, you find out that the Pure Ones are developing some sort of weird technology based on things that they're farming out of owl pellets. That's about it. Like, they don't really go too deep into what it is. Or, you know, the bad guys are bad because they're evil. You know, the good ones are good because they're good.
The good ones are good because they protect the disenfranchised owls. The bad guys are bad because they see themselves as the genetically pure owls.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it. Like, in and of itself, fucking bizarre for a children's film.
But don't children films always have, or at least the better written ones, often have these sort of like more adult elements because they are actual stories?
Oh yeah, I completely agree. I mean, I'm not complaining about it, but that to me is like this whole thing with like children's films. It's nice to see a children's film actually having something to say like this film, but it is still kind of weird. I'm not saying that it's, you know, not welcome. It's just every time I see a children's film that tackles somewhat serious and shockingly topical issues, I'm always taken aback by it because, again, my assumption is, and Hollywood has usually not proved me wrong, children's and young adult films are normally bottom of the barrel, least common denominator, lazy, trite garbage.
From what little I have seen of kids' films, I would agree. And yeah, as I, you know, said earlier, like that scene at the end where the two brothers have to confront each other is, you know, doesn't really pull any punches.
No, it doesn't. And you know, there is an emotional core to this film. Jim Sturgess's performance as Soren is really good. And look, I love Jim Sturgess. I don't think Jim Sturgess is in enough stuff. I know that Across the Universe has its detractors. I enjoy it for what it is. But Jim Sturgess, I find to be a rather likable, charismatic actor. Obviously, it's just his voice in this film. But he does a good job. And, you know, you have a really, really, really established and quality supporting cast with David Wenham, Helen Mirren, Jeffrey Rush, Joel Edgerton, Hugo Weaving, Sam Neill for a couple minutes. Like, there's a lot going on in this movie with everyone who's not the main character. And I'm really shocked by how good everything but the action scenes are in this movie and how invested I was, given that this is, again, a movie made by Zack Snyder about owls.
So your friends didn't lead you astray?
No, and I didn't, and, you know, that's...
Why did you take fucking 10 years to watch the movie, then?
I took 10 years to watch the movie, Cullen, because it's a Zack Snyder movie about fucking owls.
And it took someone to pay.
Well, hey.
Next time your friends tell you to watch a Zack Snyder movie, you should.
Here's the problem, though. If I told you to watch a Zack Snyder movie, and I told you, hey, Cullen, why don't you go watch Man of Steel? You would get back to me and say, Chris, why the fuck did you ask me to watch this movie? It is a poor representation of one of the most interesting superheroes ever put to comic book. And I know that that might be an unpopular opinion, but for me, I have always found Superman to be one of the most interesting comic book characters, because there's a lot of things to mine about a character not from this planet coming to this planet and trying to figure out a way to adapt and blend in, but also has this internal struggle of trying to do the right thing. And I've always found that intrinsically interesting. And then Zack Snyder comes along and makes a movie where Superman kills the main villain at the end of the movie, which, fucking spoilers, by the way, I know that that's not really a spoiler anymore, but...
It was for me. Thanks a lot.
I mean, Cullen, are you going to watch the movie?
If you ask me to.
I wouldn't, though. That's my point. It's... When you talk about Zack Snyder and his approach to everything that is essentially comic book film, because Zack Snyder's filmography, for the most part, is comic book film after comic book film after comic book film. And I'm not talking about comic book films like DC, you know, which he obviously has had his paws in from the get-go. I mean, Man of Steel is where the DCEU sprouted from. And you have a film like 300, Watchmen, Man of Steel, Batman v Superman, Justice League. And it's just like, dude, You are the kind of person who is perfect for making comic book films. If only you could bring some substance to it, because your style is so generic and uninteresting that I don't know why anyone continues to give you a job, other than the fact that you are probably bland enough as a director to come on to a comic book film set and just do what they want you to do and say, okay, that's what you want, I'll do it. To me, I've always wondered, because like I've been talking about with Zack Snyder and action scenes, that is when Zack Snyder can shine as a director. He has an eye for action. Whether or not it's something that I like when it comes to slow motion, or, you know, zooming in on small details, like in this film where we're talking about, you know, the blades of the owl's talons. You know, he has an eye for action, but everything else is so generic and bland that it almost feels like you're putting the horse before the carriage. Oh, the action's great and nothing else matters. And thankfully, this movie kind of sidesteps that. I'm going to put a lot of credit in the fact that I'm assuming the books, and neither one of us read the books by Catherine Lasky probably do a rather good job of giving these characters interesting characterizations. Zack Snyder, on the other hand, doesn't know how to write characters or create memorable characters. All he knows how to do is take someone else's ideas and seemingly ruin them.
So you would put this at the top of Zack Snyder's body of work?
I mean, of the things that I've seen, Cullen, this is the best Zack Snyder film I've ever seen. I'm not, that is not even fucking hyperbole. Like, Dawn of, and you know what? It would have been Dawn of the Dead, but I give him no credit, because the only reason Dawn of the Dead is good is because James Gunn wrote the fucking script for that movie.
I mean, he's a great writer.
He fucking is. Like, James Gunn is a great writer and a great director. Not a great comedian, but, you know, everything else is great. I mean, that's the issue here, is I love everything about Guardians other than the action.
So you like the non-action scenes, but you also think they're bland.
But that's okay. Like,
okay.
I mean, that's okay, right? Like, but it's okay because the performances are so good. Like, the performances are so good that, like, it just kind of overshadows the fact that it's not anything particularly out of the box or novel other than it's CGI owls.
Yeah, which is, there's not a lot of owl movies.
that's... Boy, that's a sad fact, isn't it?
There are, I was not looking.
There aren't enough.
Nah, there's not many. And I mean, it's a well-made movie, this thing. I mean, I give some of the other scenes a little more credit for some sort of style. I don't know Snyder's work, so... But especially on second viewing, there's, you know, a lot of attention to detail, you know, the claws, you know, the books, the... you know, the owls even have their own stamp, you know, for their signature, you know, from, you know, so he's able to, the young owl is able to recognize, like, oh, you're the author of this work. There's a lot of detail to, you know, the world that's been created.
It feels like a fully fleshed out world. I mean, I will say, when we're, you know, at the beginning of the film, when you're introduced to Soren and Clud and their sister, and all of a sudden they fall out of the tree and it's like, here we go, the adventure is begun. I have a hard time with movies like this sometimes, where it's like the film just fucking goes and there's not like a rising action. The rising action just immediately happens and all of a sudden the characters are thrust into the situation. For some reason I'm not, and I don't know why. It doesn't make me uncomfortable, but it always makes me feel like I haven't had a moment to breathe. And I know that that's the director's point, but for some reason that just never resonates with me. But in this movie, for some reason, I don't know. It was just, I was like, okay, yeah. I think I kind of, for some reason, I let my guard down with this movie a little bit more than I normally do.
The style of, you know, narrative beginnings that you're talking about reminds me of all the Dakin books that I've been reading. You know, for anyone who's not read his stuff, pulp writer from the 40s, he moved into doing paperback originals in the 50s. Maybe he had done radio stuff in the 30s before that. But yeah, his books literally begin like, you know, chapter one, like shit get, you know, things get off to a start very quickly. And they never really tone down, like, especially the novels unfold usually over the course of 24 or 48 hours, the main character normally doesn't even sleep. So that is my style of, you know, storytelling. Like,
but I like it in books. Is that weird? Like, I don't like it in films, but in books, I love it. It's weird, right? Like,
no, different storytelling mediums.
That's fair.
I mean, in general, I like things that get off to a fast pace. That's just my style. I was glad this wasn't 2.5 hours.
You know, that's a little surprising, right? Like, when I sat down to watch this movie, I thought it was going to be a 2-hour film. And I will say, it probably could have benefited from, like, another 10 minutes.
No.
You don't think so?
No.
I think it could have benefited from 10 minutes at the beginning of the movie. Just to further flesh out the world a little bit. Because, like, you don't really understand... Like, you know, the character of Soren tells, you know, the story about the legends at the beginning of the film. And then all of a sudden you're like, no, this shit's real. These aren't stories. And I needed a little bit more time at the beginning to let the intro to the film breathe, to get to know the characters a little bit better. Because the character of Clud, Soren's brother who eventually turns on him, I don't feel like we're given enough time with that character to fully understand why he turns on his brother. Other than the fact that, oh, his brother can fly a little bit better than he can.
It says it all. It's brotherly rivalry.
I know, but I wanted a little bit more, and that's on me, not on the film. Like, that's a me thing. And, like, that's the thing that I think a lot of critics and people who talk about art need to kind of get a better wrangle on, myself included, is what I want and what the filmmaker does are two different things, and I can't fault a filmmaker for doing something if it's not what I would have done.
Well, that's kind of what I was trying to get at earlier when you're asking me what I thought about this movie, and my only reaction is, this is totally unlike anything I normally watch. And it's, to me, it's been this conversation's been really enlightening to me, just trying to talk about this, because I've just been thinking about it in my own head for the past 2 days. It's strange to talk about something that you're not familiar with. It's strange to, you know, try and evaluate and figure out how you feel about something that doesn't have, you know, a lot of connections to other stuff that you know about. And sometimes, you know, you can see something or hear something for the first time and just realize, like, I fucking love it. That's how I felt when I heard Ernest Tubb for the first time. Like, I didn't know a lot of country music, but I heard Ernest Tubb and immediately I was like, whatever this is, I love this. I'm into it. But I think on the other hand, sometimes having a little bit of context does help for evaluating something, figuring out what's going on, even just understanding your own relationship to it. You know what I mean?
No, I completely agree. I mean, again, I think that is a conversation that the public, the art consuming public, whatever art you consume, be it books or TV or film or manga or audiobooks or whatever you consume, there is a part of it where you need to divorce yourself from what you're listening to, watching, or reading, right? Like, you just have to at some point.
One would think.
But then you get people that can't, and it's just like, yikes, you know?
I think it's hard, because I feel like, I think that's what makes writing actually really good, insightful criticism incredibly difficult. Finding the balance between having a personality, having, personality is the wrong word, a perspective, because, like, you're reading a critic because you want to know what's going through their mind, what they're thinking about it. Because there's no way that one critic can tell everybody what they are going to think about something. So really a critic does kind of have to think about themselves and their relationship to the work. But on the other hand, how do you make that accessible to a reader? How do you give them something so they can have some elements to think, like, is this going to work for me? What am I going to think about this? It's really hard to balance that.
Yeah, and I mean, again, I found myself doing it just now, and I, you know, it just kind of, it is one of those things that when you are so involved with something, like you and I are, you with Pulp Serenade, myself with this podcast, and then you and I together sitting here and talking about this film, it is hard to go, well, I like this movie, but here are the things that I don't personally like. And it's like, your subjective opinion on what you don't like is different from the objective opinion of whether or not this is a well-made film. Because, look, there are things I don't like about this movie, but that's me, and that's my opinion. objectively, this is a good film. This is a you and I would both agree this is a well-made film. I mean, you've already said it. You know, it is a well-made, good-looking, well-acted, well-produced, I wouldn't say well-shot because of the action scenes, but it is a well-made, polished product.
Yeah. It's entertaining, it moves, it's got comedy. Oh my god. The one thing that I am not gonna allow taste for, that fucking song. It's terrible.
So hold on a second. Do you know the name of the band?
I do because of this movie, because I had heard that other goddamn song they did about Fireflies, and it is the most annoying, obnoxious song, and for years I've just had this distaste for it, and finally I heard the voice in this, and I'm like, what is this? And I looked up, and it's like Owl City.
Yeah. It is the... I was taking some notes, and in my notes I took down, if this is the song I think it is by the artist I think it is, because I didn't know who it was immediately, I wrote, if this is who I think it is, this movie can take a big step back and fuck itself, because it was like, oh, come on. Artist... I mean, it's hilariously, like, punches itself in its own face, right? Like, haha, we'll make the joke for you. You don't need to make the joke for us.
And the song was written for the movie.
Uh-huh, 100%.
Yeah. And again, like, here's me being, you know, a jerk. I can totally see kids liking that song. That band is, like, popular and famous. Like, clearly, you know.
They were. Oh. And by they, I mean one person. Because Owl City is just one guy.
Well, he made a popular sound, or, you know, didn't make it.
Well, I mean, he did. Barred. I mean, but here's the thing. You knew exactly who it was when you heard it, and so did I. Because Owl City's music is so recognizable.
But he aped his sound from the Postal Service.
Well, yeah.
Which I'm sure, you know, Ben Gibbard and the other guy who's in that, his other group was Dental. Yeah, I can't remember the other person's name. I wasn't really that into them either. Anyway, I don't like that song. Clearly, I can see kids really loving that. And, you know, it's, you know, whatever, it's got guitars, it's got a beat, it's got metaphors, it's happy.
It just, it feels so out of place in the movie, though, doesn't it? Like, because up until that point, there has been no music with lyrics, and then all of a sudden it's like, hey, everybody, we're the owls, and we're flying around, and it's like, whoa,
that what? Feels like kids' movies to me. I feel like you always need, like, a single.
But that's my point. I found it out of place because, again, there's part of me that's like, this is really not a kids' movie. But, like, at the same time, it totally is a fucking kids' movie.
To me, like, it had... I guess maybe that's, like, the contradiction of this movie that kind of makes it really interesting is there's a lot of elements that are not standard for kids' movies, and then there's a lot of elements that really are. I would love to hear... You should have got some, like, you know, kids on this show with us.
You know, I don't think the optics of that would be great. Hey, children, want to join us in a dark room?
Don't you have any, like, nephews or nieces? Nope. Cousins?
Nope. Sure don't.
I mean, I don't either, so...
So that's why we're here. That's why it's just the two of us, two old assholes talking about a movie with animated owls. And that's the show, folks.
But yeah, I mean, I'd be curious to... I mean, I'm not the target audience for this movie.
Neither of us are.
This is true. But maybe that's what they're going for, because half of it's a kid's movie and half of it is not a kid's movie. And I think it's pretty successful melding those two things together.
I would be inclined to agree with you. I mean, again, I think it's a kids movie enough. You know, you have characters being stabbed with burning sticks and falling into fire. But, I mean, again, that's stock and trade for kids movies. I mean, as weird as that sounds, I mean, look at something like Lion King. Look at a lot of the Disney films. I mean, especially the ones from the 90s where you have characters being murdered, you know, and even up until recent ones. I mean, Disney has seemingly strayed farther away from killing villains in their films. If you notice that, it's super noticeable now all of a sudden, especially if we're talking like Disney films. But I do appreciate that this film doesn't kind of bend itself too far down into strictly for kids. Because again, if this were a film just for kids, I'm not sure the two of us would have enjoyed it as much as we kind of did. Like if this were a straight children's film, I think you and I would be having a different conversation about how bizarre a film this is for kids.
I mean, it's funny because talking to you, it seems less of a kid's movie than which is me talking to myself. Talking to myself. Nobody's home.
Except for them owls. Hooting from the... Hooting from the hills.
Sorry, I'm singing Guns N' Roses.
No, you're good.
It happens. I'm drinking Coca-Cola, so I'm on a sugar high.
Of the owls in the film, which one was your favorite? Do you like that question? It's like the most stupid goddamn question I've ever asked on this podcast. Yeah, what's like your favorite owl?
I mean, I'm forgetting his name, but it's the old guy owl who, like, you know, works for the pure ones, who, you know, teaches them how to fly, and then, you know, kind of gets his ass kicked / killed.
Oh, Grimble.
Yeah. Grimble, that's his name, yeah. I don't know, I liked him, because he had a, you know...
He had a story. He had a
flashback. He has a very noir story, which is just like, oh, shit, you know, I tried to fight back. They threatened to, you know, kill my wife and child, so I agreed to go to their side, and I've just been punishing myself ever since. Like, that's some, like, deep, like, noir self-loathing. I like him.
But then, as children's films would do, he is murdered, like, two minutes later.
I mean, that's also noir.
Yeah, it's fair. I mean, you know, I liked Hugo Weaving's performance in this film. He was kind of pulling double duty as Soren's father and the Grimble character. But man, I'll tell you what, fucking Joel Edgerton, practically unrecognizable voice in this film playing Metal Beak. And Joel Edgerton is one of those actors who I have in the past said, hey, this dude is as bland can be. Him and Sam Worthington and Joel Kinnaman and... Oh, God, what's the other dude's name from Suicide Squad? Oh, my God. Oh, God. I can see his face. I can hear his voice. And he is as vanilla as they come.
Bro McBro Muffin?
Pretty much. I mean, you know, Joel Edgerton is so good as Metal Beak. Like, the villain in this film is really good and he's really scary. Like, the character design is genuinely, if you're a child and you're watching this film, it's a genuinely terrifying villain.
I agree. Speaking of the villain, though, and it's sort of in the narrative, a lot of this kind of seems like Star Wars, right? Is it just
me? Well, I mean, anything is Star Wars if you boil it down to its base elements, right? I mean, even Harry Potter is pretty much Star Wars. Joseph Campbell should get all the credit for pretty much anything regarding the hero's journey because, yeah, this film is pretty much Star Wars.
But it's because it's got the hero's journey, it's got, you know... The villain with the mask, you know, it's got the, you know, the mythic, you know, saviors, you know, just like the Jedi, you know, there's even like the ending when he has to go and drop the bomb and, you know, sort of blow up the Death Star like thing and stop the weapon. There's so many elements that are just like straight from Star Wars. And I'm like, you know, that's, I mean, if you're going to rip a movie off that is going to entertain millions. That's a pretty good movie to rip off.
And it's worked in the past for so many authors. J.K. Rowling. I mean, Harry Potter is really pretty much fucking Star Wars. I mean, way more than this is.
I have only read one Harry Potter book. I have not seen any of the movies, and I did not enjoy the book at all.
Which one did you read?
The first one. It was in a class.
Well, the first one is not great, primarily because it is a children's book.
But Harry's so lame. Like,
Harry is lame throughout the entire series. He is the least well-fleshed out character in the books.
Yeah, okay, that's, well, because I mean, I'm not going to read the rest of them, but he's not a hero. He doesn't do anything. His friends do the puzzle, and then he just touches, like, the, you know, lightning bolt on his forehead, and the villain goes away. It's just like, he's just, like, super privileged.
I mean, he is. Completely. I mean, that is a criticism of those books, and I 100% agree with you.
Like, that's... I mean, maybe this goes back to, like, me as a kid, like, the movies I watched, like... Yeah, like, children protagonists, just, like... To me, like, the Harry Potter thing is just like, oh my god, this is another kid protagonist. This is what I didn't like about kids' movies. I much more gravitated towards, I mean, you know, more, you know, characters of action who do things. I didn't necessarily understand it at the time, but, like, I loved Guns of Navarone with, like, Gregory Peck. And, it's an action adventure movie, espionage, but like they speak multiple languages. They have skills that they have learned and studied. It's not just, it's like, you know, they have like sort of like the macho, like outdoorsy quality, but they also have this like brainy intellectual quality. And that's how they can, you know, try and fulfill the mission. And like, I loved that as a kid. And like looking back, I'm like, oh yeah, I can see that those characters are like more fleshed out. They actually do things, like they have to struggle in order to succeed. And then Harry Potter doesn't struggle at all, at least in that one book. I haven't read the others. And again, I didn't, when I, you know, watched Guns of Navarone at, you know, 9 or 10 years old, I wasn't like, I really appreciate the struggle and the multilingual quality of these characters.
Well, I mean, again, I think to your point, when you're talking about something like, I mean, again, good example, Harry Potter, children's YA / children's entertainment, you are an author writing for a group of people that you do not think care about actual character motivations, progressions, arcs, especially an 8-book arc or 7-book arc, excuse me, 8-film, 7-book arc, like Harry Potter. Those people being children, you assume, as the author, J.K. Rowling, who's a massive piece of shit, just want to point that out, you assume that children are not going to care or be invested in characters enough to care if they go on a journey. And the funny thing is, Cullen, if you went and read the last Harry Potter book, your feelings on Harry Potter as a character would probably change 180. Because all of a sudden, a decade later, I think, J.K. Rowling has to write books for an audience that has aged with the character. And this audience is now wanting character development and characters that are fleshed out and actually have wants and needs and desires and are actual human beings that are completely constructed out of an author's mind. And that's the weird thing about something like Harry Potter, because you watch the first movie, you read the first book, and you're like, what you just said. Harry Potter is a lame character. In those first couple movies, he is a complete and utter blank slate that you are using to get, you are using him as the blank slate to get through the rest of the films, and everyone else is imprinting on him. He's not imprinting on everyone else. And when you get to the fourth book, which is the film that I think should have been the two-parter, not the finale, but you could make the case either way, you finally start to see this character start growing and having a real character development. And that's because J.K. Rowling's audience is now 16, 17, 18. And they finally are like, can you write something for people our age? Can you continue this story but actually build in a direction that matters? As opposed to just going, yeah, well, I mean, his friends are going to play chess and then he's going to run off. And like you said, he's going to touch the thing in his pocket and he's going to touch the guy's face. And that's it. It's like the longer the series went, the more complex the character became. And that's really strange. When it comes to YA.
That's the nicest thing I've heard anyone say about those books. I mean, it's also the most intelligent thing I've heard anyone say about those books.
Of the time, it's a bunch of people going, what house are you? And it's like, I mean, hey, you know what? That's fine. I've done the Pottermore thing. Look, I'm a huge Harry Potter fan. And this is coming from someone who has never really been into fantasy. I, for the longest time, refused to give any credence to Lord of the Rings being a good film series or Harry Potter being something I should get into. I read Harry Potter, the book series. I want to say I was living here in Nebraska, so it would have been in between. It was probably like 2017 or 2018. And then like I'm a 27-year-old, 28-year-old adult. And yet I finally got around to reading all the Harry Potter books. I read all of them in the span of, I think, like 6 months, maybe less. And, you know, It's a book series that, like I said, it kind of moves with the audience. And that's strange because it's like an anomaly in the world of children's literature, because it goes from children's books to kind of adult. It goes from children to YA to adult. And you don't really ever see that, especially in mainstream, high profile, biggest franchises of all time, intellectual properties.
I feel like this movie with the owls, like it's, I think there's some pretty decent character development. I mean, as
I agree.
You put it out, there are multiple novels to pull from, but I feel like they did a pretty good job of, you know, nailing the characters and the complexity of them. in a very succinct way.
Well, and this book series, Guardians of Ga'Hoole, was written over a decade. It was written from 2003 to 2013. So the audience probably moved with this series as well. I mean, maybe not as much, but, you know, I haven't read it. You haven't read it. It's not because we didn't want to. It's just sometimes you don't have all the time in the world to commit to reading three books about owls, because this film is not only about the first book, it's actually about the second book and the third book.
I'm finishing a dissertation. Please right. Forgive me, people who are listening to this.
Fans of the owls. But, to your point, like, there is a lot of character development in this film. Again, and that's welcome in a film like this. That is, again, ostensibly made for a younger demographic. And you know what? If I had a kid and I took my kid to this film, I would have been as entertained as they were. And that is the sign of a good children's film, if an adult can still be entertained by it.
I was going to say, what that reminds me of is, I've been trying to remember, it's from one of Richard Schickel's The Men Who Made the Movies interviews. It's either with Raoul Walsh or William Wellman, and they were talking about making films before ratings were a thing. And, you know, even pre-ratings, there were still movies that were targeted towards younger audiences, films that were targeted towards older audiences. But they were saying one of the challenges was because there's more of a likelihood of mixed demographics going to the same movie. One of the challenges they said they really liked was, how do you make a movie that's going to play well to a younger audience, you know, to audiences, you know, 10 years older, and then 10 years older than them, and 10 more, and 10, you know, and so on and so forth. And they were saying they felt that, you know, they thought the movies after the ratings were sometimes a little too, like, in the pocket for their target audience. And I do think that is a strength of this movie. I think it does play to, you know, presumably different audiences pretty well, because there's things that would entertain kids, there's things that are a little more complex for adults. And I do feel like that is one of the strengths of older Hollywood movies and why they endure so much. You know, a movie like Meet Me in St. Louis, it's not a kids movie at all, but there are kids in it, and it's in it, you know, there are different generations of children in that movie that are all going through their own different narratives. And there's also the narratives of the parents and the people that work for the parents and the community. And to me, that's Meet Me in St. Louis is one of my favorite movies. And I think that is a brilliant example of a movie that can play to not only play to different generations, but have those different generation stories contained within the same film.
I find it interesting because, again, talking about children's or younger demographic focused films, it's funny to me because I feel like post Disney purchasing both Marvel and Star Wars, you could make the case that Marvel films and Star Wars films are for children. And I don't think you would be wrong, but that's not a knock at those films. That is a success that those films can not only bring in and entertain adult audiences, but they're also accessible to children without pandering. And yeah, the Marvel films and the Star Wars films have their fucking problems. And I'm not going to sit here and go and launch into each problem and break it down succinctly beat by beat. But if you disagree that Marvel films and Star Wars films are not ostensibly family / younger demographic geared films, you're missing the point of those films entirely. The point of those films is for everyone to be able to enjoy them.
Isn't that... I mean, I agree with you, and I sort of feel like that is the genius / curse of George Lucas. The marketability of Star Wars, like, completely changed how you make a movie, how you market movie, you know, the relationship between the spectators and the movie, the relationship between the spectators and the culture around the movie and fan culture. So I think you're 100% because, you know, the franchisability of movies today would not be, you know, what it is without Star Wars. Speaking of which, how is there only one of these owl movies?
So that's kind of the strange thing, right? Because The way the film ends, spoilers, because we really haven't talked about a lot of the film's particulars. Because honestly, I don't know about you, Cullen, but I think anyone should go watch this film. I think this is a genuinely interesting film that you should go form your own opinion on, you being the listener. It's a bizarre film. It's a film about CGI owls, and it has an open-ended ending. It has kind of, not a cliffhanger, but it does sow the seeds for a sequel. And to your point, it's been a decade, and we have seen nothing in the way of another film, another series, them approaching this to do it again in another format, being it a cartoon on a children's network or on Netflix or Hulu. And I don't know why, because everyone involved seemed to have a vested interest in turning this into the next Harry Potter, Percy Jackson, however you want to spin it. And yet we don't have anything.
Yeah, it's a shame.
And it is, because after 2010, there has been no talk of a sequel. Jim Sturgess and Ryan Kwanten said in 2010 they would reprise their roles if there was ever a sequel, but that was a decade ago. And sure, in Hollywood, things can get made 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years later. I don't think The Legends of the Guardians is going to be one of those things that gets a sequel to it. If anything, we'll get a new version of this, but I don't even think we'll get that. And it's a shame, because again, for kind of my trepidation with sitting down and watching this film, I don't know about you, but I kind of want to see where the story is going.
Are you going to read the books?
Well, I don't know about that. I mean, I don't know.
Oh,
I mean,
come on.
I mean, here's the thing. Like we talked about on the last podcast that you were on, Cullen, it'll go on a list of things that I will never get to. So,
fair.
You know, I mean, they're like fucking 16 books. You know, they're probably not the most taxing reads.
Hey, but you were 27. Did you think you were going to read all the Harry Potter books?
No. So are you saying that now that I'm 30, I should read all of the Owl books?
Yeah.
Okay, then I'll
do it. If you want, I mean.
No, I'll do it. I think you're right. I think genuinely, if I have an interest in figuring out where the story goes, how else am I going to find out? Hemin and Han that they didn't make a sequel? No, I have to sit down and read the fucking books or listen to them on audiobook, which is probably the more likely scenario if they're on audiobook, which they were written in the last 20 years, so pretty high chance that they're audiobooks. But if not, I'm sure I could find cheap copies of the book somewhere, because like most YA books, they're probably stinking up a shelf at Half Price Books or any of your local bookstores. Are you going to read them, Cullen?
I mean, never say never, but it's not... At the moment, my reading is planned already well into 2021, so I don't think I can... These are things I have to read either for, freelance writing gigs, books I'm working on, or my dissertation. So I don't think I'm going to be... It's going to fall into what I have to read, if that makes any sense.
Well, no, because, I mean, again, I have lamented... to anyone who will listen, that I am convinced that the reason reading has been beaten out of our society as a pastime or something that you do for fun, because academia said, fuck you, this is what you're going to read, and I'm going to tell you what to think about it. And people don't read. I mean, like, people...
I read for fun, though. I mean, like...
I know, but here's the thing, so do I, but you and I are exceptions that prove the rule. Do you go ask a lot of people that you know, do you read for fun? Do you read? It's because I feel like it's beaten out of us in academia, and people are forced to read. And if people were just said, hey, here are some books, would you like to read something of this? As opposed to, you're going to read the things that they carried, and we're going to talk about the Vietnam War.
Oh, God, I love that book. That was...
It's not a bad book, but you know what I mean.
Well, it's... To go back to what we were talking about like an hour ago, that was something like I found on the shelf when I was like 10. And it was just like, I could be reading what they tell me to read in school, or I can read this. And The Sweetheart of the Song Trabong was a lot more interesting than, the stuff they're giving me that was more age appropriate.
But see, here's the problem. When I was 17 in high school, I was reading stuff like Dante's Inferno and by Douglas Preston and Lincoln Child, like horror novels and horror sci-fi novels, because that's kind of my wheelhouse of the things that I liked at the time.
That sounds good.
Well, yeah, but then I was told you have to read the things that they carried, and it was like, man, I'm not into this. Like, I wasn't into it at the time. I mean, I'm about halfway through reading the Ken Burns and I forget the other gentleman's name book about the Vietnam War. Like I'm about two-thirds of the way through it, and it's like a 40-hour book. I don't know how many pages it is, but it's more of a, you know, I could have let that beat reading out of me. I chose not to because I already loved reading. But I mean, you know what I mean? Like people get the love of reading beaten out of them when they're told to read something that they have no interest in reading. And then they have to sit in class and, you know, kibitz with the teacher, and then they're told, well, your interpretation is wrong. Which, by the way, is a problem. That is a massive problem.
I'm not planning on reading the books, which is not a... It is less of a sign of, like, oh no, I don't want to, more of than, like, I literally have, like, you know, piles of things I have to read for, you know, either articles I'm writing or, like, you know, some book projects that I'm, like, in the middle of. So my, you know, even though it's things I enjoy reading and it will be fun, like, the likelihood that I'm going to be able to, like, slip in some stuff, like, The Guardians of Ga'Hoole is just not likely.
And you want to hear something crazy? The first 30 minutes of this movie is the first book in the series.
They did a good job.
Yeah, the first book in the series is about Soren and his brother getting captured and then escaping at the end of the first book. And then the second book is about their journey to the island, or the tree, the Great Ga'Hoole tree. And so it's like, it's even more interesting to me that, like, those, how short are these books? Like, the way that the film does it, it's like, these are like 10-minute experiences. That is an entire novel when you break it down to the novel version of the film.
Dang.
It's pretty, I mean, it's pretty wild, but I mean, again, it's also, I mean, again, it's YA fiction, so I'm not expecting that it's a 500-page tome either, so there is that.
I think they did a good job of keeping the story moving. Like, it's a lot of ground is covered, and I feel like a lot of times movies, I just finished watching The Haunting of Bly Manor, and they repeat things over and over and over again. And then she got up and walked, and she walked, and she walked. They do this so many times, they just keep beating it over your head in case you didn't get it. And this film doesn't do it. They tell things once, and then the story keeps moving, and I really appreciate that. It, you know, it makes you the movie assumes that you are listening and that you have a brain.
Which is shocking for a quote-unquote younger demographic film.
Yeah, it's for any movie. Haunting of Bly Manor is not meant for kids. And it's even that is decently written. I mean, there's some episodes that are terribly written, but there's some other ones that are quite well written. But
sure,
even the ones that are well written have that tendency to browbeat things into you. I don't think I'm using that phrase correctly. My caffeine high is wearing off.
What would you give Legend of the Guardians, The Owls of Ga'Hoole, out of 5?
I don't know, like 3, 3.5. Like, it gets back to what we were talking about earlier. This is a very well-made movie. Is it my type of movie? It doesn't have Burt Reynolds in it, and it doesn't have Charles Bronson in it, and it's Charles Bronson's birthday.
And both of those gentlemen were still alive when this film came out, weren't they? At least Burt Reynolds was.
Bronson wouldn't have been.
Can you imagine if there was an owl in this film voiced by Burt Reynolds?
Oh, he would have fucking loved that, and he would have killed it. He would have been good as an owl.
I mean, you have Anthony LaPaglia in this film, who is practically unrecognizable, and he does an amazing job.
Oh my god, what the heck is this? There was something we watched, my girlfriend Lauren and I, and like Charles Bronson does like a penguin impression, and now I'm just like, man, I'm just trying to like imagine Charles Bronson as an owl, and I'm very happy with these thoughts going through my head. So yeah, I don't know, 3.5, does that seem fair?
Well, that's what I was going to give it. So we're right on the same page. I mean, again, it's a well-made film. I have my issues with it, but, you know, I want to give a sincere apology to my two buddies who have been trying to convince me to watch this goddamn movie for the last decade.
They shouldn't let you forget that.
They won't.
Good.
I will be friends with them until the end of time, and on my deathbed, they're going to look at me and go, Remember he didn't watch the fucking Owl movie for a decade? I'd be like, yes, I know, the Owl movie. Leave me alone about the fucking Owl movie.
It's going to be part of your eulogy.
Yeah. And then we told Chris to watch The Owls of Ga'Hoole. May he soar to the heavens, my friend. Oh, my God.
Just as long as they don't play the song at your funeral.
Well, I mean, it would be kind of par for the course if they did, to be fair. So.
All right, then that's...
I get what I deserve at that point. Maybe I deserve to have the Owl City song played at my funeral. Oh, boy. But on that note, let's take a break and we'll play a preview for the next Culture Cast.
This is the farm. Peaceful. Calm. Civilized. But now, the only chance to save the farm is for one little pig.
He can't leave. You're my lucky pig.
To go to the city.
You can't leave, huh? You can't leave.
Anybody home? Anybody else?
Somebody! Let me in!
He's entered a world of outcasts and misfits.
Who are these losers?
Well, hey, slow down. If you're not a cat, stay a chat.
I'm hungry.
Fleetly, come back. We don't know where it's been.
Separated from his owner.
I seem to have lost my human.
Totally on his own.
You're just a little pig in the big city. What can you possibly do? What can anyone do?
Destiny has changed his mission. And his courage is about to change everyone's lives.
Whatever the pig says, goes.
Find my moi.
My tummy hurts.
Pack your bags.
Time to go.
We're going outside without a human.
And hang on tight.
Let go, Felix!
Hey, I'm swimming over here.
Save the farm, babe! Save the farm!
Ah! Ferdinand the Duck, witness to insanity.
From the heart of the city, comes the story of a pig with heart.
I have a professional obligation to be malicious.
Then you should change jobs.
That'll do, Piggy. That'll do.
Babe, Pig in the City.
This place can really take it out of you.
Tell me about it.
I'm still hungry.
That's right, on the next Culture Cast, we are shockingly going to be talking about yet another film featuring talking animals. We're going to be talking about George Miller's Babe, Pig in the City.
Oh, right,
which
on.
Which has been described to me as a postmodern classic.
Co-written by, didn't someone from Razorback co-write that movie?
I believe one of the female leads in Razorback helped co-write the film. Yeah, it's Judy Morris.
So she worked on, Babe, Pig in the City.
Yep, she also worked on Happy Feet 2, also directed by George Miller. So, George Miller has an interesting filmography, to say the least.
Yeah, it's a pretty great one.
Yeah, Happy Feet, Babe, Pig in the City, Fury Road. How can you go wrong there? But yeah, that's what we're going to be talking about in the next podcast, is Babe, Pig in the City. So until then, Cullen, what have you been up to?
I've been writing a lot about Dakin. I've just been doing mainly Pulp Serenade, pulp-serenade.com, writing a ton about Dakin since I'm hoping to turn... The blog posts I'm writing are stepping stones to larger articles and hopefully something larger about Gunnar Hjertstedt, a.k.a. Dakin, pulp writer, extraordinaire in my opinion. That and working on my dissertation, which is not about Dakin or owls, unfortunately.
I was about to say that's a bummer that it's not about owls.
No, it's about... I'm supposed to have an elevator pitch, but I don't have one. It's basically about community, sense of community, motivation within virtual communities.
Hmm.
So I'm looking at Discogs and 45 Cat and whether a sense of community influences the cataloging behavior of its members.
Well, you had me at Discogs. which is a great website if you've never visited it, where you can index your vinyl and also sell your vinyl and buy vinyl. And I have done all three of those things on Discogs. So my favorite, I love Discogs.
My favorite part is you can do research on records.
Well, that too.
To me, what is extraordinary about Discogs is it is an entirely user-generated bibliographic, or in this case, discographic database. You can't find anything comparable about books in any university or the Library of Congress or anywhere. It's like all of the records all over the world you can, you know, navigate by, you know, record label, by the, you know, the mastering engineers.
By the pressing numbers on the vinyl itself.
Yeah. There's nothing like that for books. And it's
Which is a fucking shame.
I agree. And part of what I'm, the reason I'm doing this dissertation is a lot of the literature about, what do they call it? Social cataloging is about like, oh, user-generated tags are unsophisticated. You know, how can we integrate this into the, cataloging, which is done by a professional? And it's like at Discogs, non-librarians are cataloging with the same level of detail and sophistication that professionally trained catalogers are cataloging and being paid for it. There's no reason that, tagging has to be unsophisticated. It's just, the interface is, incredibly well designed at Discogs, and it allows people to catalog records in very intimate and, intricate detail. And, anyway, that is my dissertation. It's asking why are these people doing this amazingly detailed work unpaid?
It feels like it's because society told them vinyl doesn't fucking matter anymore, and they looked into the void and said, yeah, fuck you, it doesn't.
See, that is the theory. Someone in the 80s came up with this theory. It's amazingly simple, and I'm just like, how the hell did you get a career based around it? But then again, maybe it's just because they iterated it and put it on paper, and they've made a career out of proving it. So applause to them. It's just called sense of community, and kind of what it says is just like people in a, there's like a 12 question, true false to gauge, the sense of community within a community. But it's like, do people here have the same values? Do people, value what I do? And it's just kind of what you said. It's like, yeah, like people within this community recognize value about this information.
Yeah. I mean, that information is important to people who care about vinyl.
Yeah. And that's what it's, in a way it's really simple, being like, oh, people within a community care about what happens within their community. I mean, it is simple, but, perhaps as evinced by certain political things where community,
sure.
People do plenty of things that, people make plenty of laws that don't, help the community. So maybe what this is saying is not so obvious to a lot of people.
Well, and again, I mean, if you look at something like vinyl in the last couple years, vinyl has outpaced every other physical media regarding music, even CDs.
Oh, yeah. Because
and that
vinyl,
to me, is like hilarious, because vinyl is standing over the corpse of CDs going, you had us in round one and two, motherfucker.
Oh,
and round three and four, prepare, because you have just been taken down to the mat.
I listen to 70-year-old records every day. They will be here long after I'm dead, as long as I take care of them. Same thing with film. 35mm prints will be around long after DCPs have degraded and hard drives have crashed. Which is why I remember, like, when Blade Runner, I think that was one of the first, like, big DCP restorations that, was being touted and, taken around to theaters. They made a 35mm print of that and put it in the Museum of Modern Art's archives, because they even knew that, hey, this DCP we're throwing around, this doesn't have a long shelf life.
We, as consumers in 2020 are spoiled by essentially not relying on physical media anymore. If you don't want to, you don't have to. I mean, you can listen to almost any song that has ever existed on your phone. You can watch almost any film that's ever existed on your phone. You can, and you know, to someone 30 years ago, that would be mind-blowing. And yet here we are sitting and going, yeah, but I still want physical media. And there's something to be said for that. There really is.
But there's, I find, you know, music and movies I want to listen to or watch every day that aren't streaming or available online.
Sure. It's a more blanket statement than it meant to be, sure. I mean, yeah, there's amount of stuff that probably never got digitized and turned into a streaming capable, like, medium is more than the stuff that has been.
This is why my apartment is turning into nothing but piles.
But you're going to be sitting one day inviting people to your apartment to talk with you about books as you sit and smoke your pipe.
Yeah.
No, something to aspire to.
Oh my goodness, I do have aspirations. They involve a chair.
And a pipe, or maybe some leather-bound books and some...
No. I want to have a chair, and I would like to have room next to the chair for a little table where I can put a glass. These are the dreams of someone that lives in New York, to have room for a chair.
And as for someone who lives not in New York, my aspirations are similar. I would like to be left alone and do my own thing and just listen to music and read and just... Everybody needs to take a minute, take a deep breath, and relax.
So, Krista, I'm no good with metaphors because I've never been good at them. But to ask the question to you of what you asked me, that sentence is really bad. I got to work on my grammar. What are you up to?
Oh, nothing. Surviving, you know, watching movies about owls. Maybe going to watch some movies about talking penguins so I can keep the talking bird craze going. No, you can find me on Twitter, @casualty_Chris. I'm working on a podcast right now with Mike White and Richard Haddam, and that is coming soon down the pipeline in end of November, early December.
Is that going to be on the Culture Cast or on Projection Booth?
It's a joint venture.
Do I know what this is?
It's its own thing. I guess I can kind of let the cat out of the bag. So last year, during the kind of cool down period of Kolchak the Night Stalker, when we were kind of getting to the finale of the show, I don't remember what episode it was on. I would have to go back and look. We made a joke about, you know, the Rankin and Bass Christmas specials, right? You know, Rudolph and Frosty and all that. We made a joke. I don't remember how it came about. We made a joke about a podcast called Rankin on Bass, where we talked about Rankin and Bass movies and like the specials. And that joke, we ended up saying, yeah, you know what? Let's actually do it. And so we finally did a year later. And those episodes are going to be kind of a short, intermittently posted podcast. We're not going to be, you know, keeping a monthly or weekly schedule, but we will probably post things sporadically. But yeah, Rankin on Bass, a podcast awesome. About Rankin and Bass movies.
That sounds awesome.
Well, hey man, podcasts are, podcasts are pretty great. As someone who makes them, I just love the audio medium. So, but if you want to listen to more episodes of this podcast, including one where Cullen and I talk about one of my favorite movies, Fletch, head on over to culturecast.com. We're also on Patreon at patreon.com/culturecast. Go there. $1 is all it takes to get access to bonus content. And if you give $5, you can pick a movie for us to watch. And if you say, hey, I want Chris and Cullen to watch it, you've just roped Cullen into watching it. And you know what? I just put that pox upon you. And if someone does it, it's probably my fault now. So, oops.
No, that's it's my fault. I do. I follow the flock. You are the flock.
Well, and, don't give me too big of a head or I might start branding people with my initials and starting a sex cult. I would never do that. I don't want to go to jail for 120 years. They'll let someone else do that. But yeah, Cullen, thank you so much. But thank you, Cullen, for joining me because, I knew that this film was way outside of your comfort zone. So, I agree. Make sure to check out the next episode.